Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the last of our sessions in what has been a really fascinating conference on culture and society in modern Turkey. And I must express our thanks again to our guests who came here from afar and did such a magnificent job. So thanks again for that. We have what promises to be a very interesting, enlightening, and I'm sure different kind of session to what we've had at this conference and usually at the university with the musical side, that some of which we've already heard. So I'm really very excited to introduce our two speakers on this panel, which is on modern Turkish music. And like so many other things that we've discussed about Turkish culture, obviously it has its political side to it as well. From Revolution to Indifference is the subtitle of this session. And the two speakers are Fazli Teoman Yakuolu and Yossi Eli. Yossi was very instrumental in organizing this session, as I mentioned yesterday, and now another opportunity to thank him again. It's Yossi's ideas that are behind the title and behind the guests that we are so privileged to have here. Yossi Eli has his master's degree from Boğaziçi University in Istanbul, and as such is one of the few Israelis who has a master's degree from Boğaziçi. And I certainly hope, if he is the first, that he won't be the last, and I'm sure he won't be, as I gather that there are a few other Israelis already doing graduate work at Turkish universities. And Yossi presently is pursuing his research for his doctorate under the supervision of Professor Amy Singer on Turkish urban cultural history. And it is through that Yossi comes to the angle of our present panel on music. And our second speaker, who I know I must only refer to just as Teoman, because that is how Teoman is known, a singer, songwriter, one of Turkey's biggest rockers, if not the most popular, as I have learned. Also presently studying for a master's degree in sociology at Boğaziçi University. So it is with great pleasure and great expectation too that I hand over to Yossi Eli to speak first on modern Turkish music from revolution to indifference.
Good afternoon. In this presentation, I would like to provide a glimpse on the history of Turkish popular music. Obviously, it will be will not manage to cover everything, but I would like to focus on key events, key figures that defined the nature of Turkish pop music in Turkey. And I would like to start with an anecdote relating to that, to start from the end. And that is that in 2003, Sertab Erener, one of Turkey's most popular singers, won the Eurovision Song Contest for Turkey for the first time in history. And that's after Turkey having a history of a very dismal history in Eurovision Song Contest. Some of you would remember a very infamous song by the name of Opera in 1983, which won Turkey nothing. Anyway, the thing about the song of Serta Perener, Everywhere, that, Every Way That I Can, that although she sang in English, the song had a distinctly Turkish sound. And actually, that is what Turkish music is all about. In this session, and when I say that, that is what Turkish music is all about, I refer to the constant influences, the constant interlaps between the East, Eastern or local traditions, and Western or, so to speak, universal or global musical influences. And in this session, we will explore how the music, which is how this music became very typical of Turkish, of Turkey today, how this kind of music came to life. Okay. Well, in Turkey, in Republican Turkey, we usually start with Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, and in that sense, this presentation wouldn't be that different. And much has been said about the involvement of the Turkish state in the life and activities of the citizens of the Turkish Republic. During the revolutionary period between 1923 and 1948, the Turkish state intervened in many aspects of Turkish daily life. And there are many examples of that. For that, the involvement of the state in religious activity, in family life, and so on and so forth. The thing that we must not forget, I think, is that essentially, during the early days of the Republic, the state played a conscious and pivotal role in bringing about radical change in society. Using its enormous political power, the Kemalist state aimed to create a modern, nationally aware, united Turkey. An integral part of this goal was to redefine Turkish national music. Now, that might sound a little bit strange, considering the fact that, like, music was, relatively speaking, something that, I mean, these people were involved in state, in nation building. But they were aware of the fact that music and culture was also something that defined the national identity, and they were involved in modifying it to their own will, to their own purposes. The thing is about this attempt, this endeavor of redefining national culture, was that the state attempted time and time again to impose its ideology, and we're going to see it in various points through time. It's a try to impose its ideology on the musical scene, an attempt that basically, when we look in the long run, failed each and time again. Turkish music did change between 1923 and 1998. This is the point where I start. But the change was independent from state intervention. Now, let's go back to this point of redefining the nature of Turkish music. And in order to understand it, a good place to start is Ziya Gökalp's famous tract of the principles of Turkism, Türkçülüğün Esasları, from 1920. Now, according to Ziya Gökalp, every aspect of Turkish life should be performed, and the language that he uses is that in this tract is that of we should do, we should adopt. He basically, the principles of Turkism is an action plan more than anything else, I think. And in this tract, Gökalp paid special attention to aesthetic Turkism, specifically the debate on national music. Gökalp claimed that Eastern music, with its hybrid origins in Greek and Arabic music, was, and I quote, Sikh and non-national. For him, again, I quote in quotes, Western music was what we today call classical music. The term folk music that he also uses quite often referred to the music of the countryside, the local music of the different areas of the country where the true Turks or true the real Turkey was to be found. Based on this belief, Gökalp appointed the music committees to take the initiative and lead the way. And when I say the music committees, I mean the music committees of the operating organ of the national movement, which was then the Türkocakları, the Turkish Hearts. He appointed them to make the initiative and lead the way in the creation of national Turkish music. Okay. In other fields of aesthetic Turkism, such as theater, plastic arts, poetry, and literature, the tune, so to speak, was very similar. Turkey should harmonize their local Turkic traditions with the forms and techniques of what he referred as civilization, that is the West. Okay? So we have here a very conscientious attempt to try and, in a way, detach Turkey, the Turkish society, from its musical traditions, and try to detach them in a way that it takes elements of that tradition and combines them with Western cultural practice. So, this is done very consciously, very aware of the fact that it is basically revolutionizing culture. Okay? After the establishment of the Republic, the ruling elite of Ankara began implementing Gökalp's ideas. In the 1930s, the Türkocakları circles, the circles that were identified with the Young Turks, were replaced by the Halk Evleri and the Halk Odaları, the people's houses and the people's rooms. The people's houses were an organ of the ruling People's Republican Party, the CHP, and were in charge of educating the masses, mostly the elderly, in remote locations. By the way, not only in remote locations, there were Halk Evleri in the cities as well. But in these institutions, teachers were sent from the big cities to teach the people basic aspects of modern lifestyle. We must understand that people were in various parts of the country, people were not aware how to use the clock or how to sit in a Western style on the table. So, like, they were teaching them basic rules of living in a modern lifestyle. It reminds some of the issues that when the massive immigration came to Israel in the 1950s, some of the things that Israelis had, the new immigrants to the country had to face. Okay? Now, they were also taught reading and writing with the new alphabet, and of course they were taught the doctrine of the party. The initial contact between the uneducated masses, so to speak, and the sophisticated urban teachers had many interesting and sometimes surreal consequences. It is reported that the teachers of the people's houses would play classical music to the village with loudspeakers. Now, one can only imagine what went in the mind of the shepherd that was crossing in front of those speakers and listening to, I don't know, Bartók's Csárdás or whatever, or an opera, or a Puccini opera. What goes in his mind as he takes his sheep to graze? Now, these were some of the things that... This is just an example of how determined these people were, and when I say the teachers at the people's house, how the people's houses, how determined they were to, in a way, uproot the old and bring in the new. Okay? Strangely enough, the people's houses experience brought about an ironic change of event. Rather than influencing the rural inhabitants and changing their musical styles, the teachers in remotely located people's houses ended up bringing the rural music to the cities. During their time in the villages, they discovered, many of those teachers discovered the turkular, the folk songs of the locality in which they were posted. Folk song already venerated at the sound of the real Turks were brought from the village to the city, adopted by city dwellers as the folkloric music of the country. There's a good example of such a personality that was discovered that way. That is the famous Ashik Veysel, the Alevi blind minstrel from the Sivas region, who later on became a folkloric and almost, I would say, like in a way, he was the first Turku celebrity in Turkey, pretty much. And this was happening in the 30s. The problem, however, was not with folk music, because as I said, folk music took part in the nationalist program. The problem was with urban music. And our dear friend here, Orhan Tikelioğlu, wrote a marvelous article on the subject. You might find it a little bit repetitive, but still, I'm going to just give it the idea. Well, the thing about urban music, that urban music in the Ottoman era had developed from Greek, Byzantine, and Arabic and Persian traditions. For many years, this music was the music of the Ottoman elite. It was like a kind of an etiquette for the Ottoman elite to listen to that, listen and in a way consume this kind of music. It was produced in the palace by composers that after one point were competing in outwitting their colleagues by producing more elaborate and more delicate compositions. By the end of the 19th century, classical Ottoman music became too elaborated, and as Mustafa Kemal described it in one occasion, lifeless. Last but not least, classical Ottoman music was part of a lifestyle that was identified with the Ottoman dynasty. Therefore, it was neither national nor in accordance with the modernist ideas of the Kemalists. Now, here we're interesting in the early Republican times, where there is an interesting attempt of trying to bring this Ottoman urban tradition and to modernize it. One of the main issues that these composers, these state people that state-employed composers, in a way, one of the issues that they were mostly concerned about was trying to make the music polyphonic, instead of the single solo performer, they created orchestras, and these choruses sang in multi many voices. Now, that is one of the attempts that was tried in these times. But that was happening in the 30s, and another policy that the state tried to impose was to ban it, literally to ban it. Now, again, I think we should try to imagine this music was the music of the people of the city in early Republican Turkey, and they decide in 1934 to ban it, to literally obliterate it in a way. This ban lasted for 20 years, but again, it demonstrates the attitude of the regime towards its own, the music of its own people. Now, this is, I think, is a very, very crucial point. Now, the thing about this music, the thing about musical taste, and I think, is, I mean, one should ask himself the question, can the state modify the musical taste of its citizens? It might intervene by developing new types of music, like, as I just gave you an example of polyphonic music, by qualifying music as good, bad, lifeless, and modern, and so on and so forth. And it might even ban broadcasts. But musical tastes, unlike the railway, the Latin alphabet, and for that matter, the Republican establishment altogether, is something that is very, very difficult to modify, I think. I mean, I'm just try to imagine yourself, like, now you're supposed to like punk or progressive rock after being used to listening to, I don't know, the Platters and the 1950s music. This is unconceivable in a way. Okay. This is, as I said, by the time of the single party, during the single party regime, pretty much the policies were outlined. But in 1950, with the rise of the Democratic Party to the government, the attitude begins to change. Now, as long as the political system was in the hand of the single party, all types of activities could be controlled and monitored most types of activities could be controlled and monitored by the ruling classes. In 1950, when the first free elections were held in Turkey, the results were very decisive. The ruling CHP was replaced by the opposition Democrat Party, DP, and this political shift brought about many changes, including a change in attitude in the attitude towards music. Now, the 1950s can be considered in some respects as a transitional period between the more restrictive, imposing, even revolutionary governments of the CHP to a more some sort of liberal democracy that came about in the 1950s. So there is this period of change, there is this transitional area, which was the 1950s. Now, in the field of music, two key changes happened. In accordance with the political upheaval that the country went through, first, an experiment in Turkish classical music known as fantasy transformed Ottoman urban music from its heavier, like the more complex formats of the palace music, to more catchy and shorter tunes. In fact, fantasy music was popularized through the implementation of modern concept of the song. Like, think of the Western song. It's relatively short. It has a phrase, a musical phrase that we call, that is known as the hook. So it's something, it's the phrase that is kept in the mind. And we have this starting to happen in fantasy music. Artists who sang this kind of music, like Zeki Müren, were elevated to stardom during the 1950s. There's another element in the story that I'm not discussing, that is the influence of film imports from the Arab states, who also made this song very acceptable and accessible, actually. The importance of fantasy, apart from its immense popularity, was that it initiated a modus operandi for later composers. By taking local music and adapting it in Western formats, fantasy composers made local music more accessible and popular. Moreover, the fantasy experience demonstrated the importance of the direct dialogue between the composer / songwriter and the audience. Although the state still controlled the means of radio of audio communication, ordinary people began consuming this music regardless of state imposition, mainly through films, and this is a feature that will recur in the 60s and the 70s. The 1950s, however, marked another important phenomenon, and that is the increasing influence of Western contemporary musical genres on Turkish music. The DP government enabled this process through its political and diplomatical choice to the side of the United States during the early years of the Cold War. Turkey joined NATO, which meant American bases on Turkish soil, which meant GIs, young GIs in American on Turkish soil, which brought their music, the 1950s music, to Turkey that way. Turks became also familiar with Coca-Cola, Hollywood movies, and of course, rock and roll. In that time, we're talking about mostly about the Elvis Presley phenomenon. Later on, and in 1955, the band of the Turkish Naval School in Istanbul played rock and roll music for the first time. In the mid-50s, Erol Büyükburç, who became Turkey's first star. By the way, when people, just as an anecdote, when people describe Erol Büyükburç to younger generation, they say that Erol Büyükburç is the Teoman of the 1950s. Yeah. Okay. He became the first star. So we also have the figure, the star, starting to appear, a Western type of star. He was very handsome. He was larger than life. He was very charismatic. And he began taking Turkish songs and mixing them with Western melodies. He liked cha-cha-cha. He did rock and roll. He did all sorts of things like that. Another thing that happened in the 1950s, that began in the 1950s, was this old tradition of arrangement or covers. I think covers is the best definition. Covers, taking songs, popular songs from Europe and the United States, translating them to Turkish, and mass marketing this. The biggest star of arrangement from all over throughout the history of arrangement is definitely Ajda Pekkan, who is now at the age of 70, I think, and still very active. No, around 70, and very active, and very, very diva-like, larger-than-life figure, ridden with sensations. The arrangement made Western music, is important in making Western music more accessible to the Turkish ear, because these are Western songs. The best, the most famous example of this arrangement songs is, I think, Her Yerde Kar Var, or Tombela Neje, of Adamo, that was later on covered, but not by Ajda Pekkan, I think, by Adamo himself into Turkish. But it was a very interesting example of this thing. And in the late 1950s, Erkin Koray, a very eccentric guitar player, took one step further and began singing Turkish folk songs using his electric guitar. And basically, during the 1950s, the foundations of the development that would follow in the next 40 years were pretty much laid. The Second Republic, the time of the Second Republic, from 1960 to 1980, first of all, they're considered in many respects the heydays of Turkish pop. When we're talking about nostalgia today in Turkey, many go back to the sounds of the 1960s and the 1970s. In Istanbul today, there are nostalgic bars that play popular songs from the 1960s and 70s, and they are very popular in that sense. The 1960s, represent the coup was a very dramatic and traumatic event in Turkish history. Ended up with the execution of a prime minister, a new constitution and new economic policy and so on and so forth. And the days, in terms of music, the days of the Second Republic saw an amazing expansion of the music industry with the new figures and styles being incorporated into the industry. What began with Erkin Koray and his electric folk music developed during the 1960s and the 70s into a powerful and very influential genre known as Anadolu Pop. Now, Anadolu Pop and his further development, Anadolu Rock, became very popular with the public, with the Turkish public. A little bit by chance, in 1964, Tülay German sang a song who would initiate this whole musical trend. It was Burçak Tarlası, The Field of Wetch. In this song, German combined folk music using rural Anatolian language with Western beats, sounds, and orchestrations. The electric guitar, as I just mentioned, became to play an more and more important part in folk music. Another thing that made it even more popular was the Golden Microphone Musical Contest in 1965, which began in 1965. This contest promoted music that was a combination of folk and Western elements. Contestants were young, new artists, and the winners received record deals. One of the contingencies of the record deal was that the winners were required to launch a year-long tour of the country. And during this tour, many of these artists, such as Cem Karaca, one of the most prominent figures of Anadolu Pop, discovered that the population in the countryside loved folk music and played in Western styles and instruments. Anadolu Pop later on also became very politicized. And this has to do with the fact that during the 1960s, political organization and affiliation became more common and more easy. And Cem Karaca, for instance, famous song Namus Belası, the curse of chastity, pretty much represents that. In this song, he discusses the problems of this notion of chastity and how it interferes with the country's development. And they're talking about building roads and things like that. So it was Anadolu Pop pretty much represented, was also a reflection of the country's political polarization at the time. Barış Manço, another very important figure, he was affiliated, so to speak, or was identified with the nationalist right. So Cem Karaca and Barış Manço, the two legendary figures, were at the same time on the opposite sides of the political map. Many rockers, and I'm assuming that Teoman would agree with me, many rockers of the 1990s perceive Anadolu Pop and Anadolu Rock as one of the defining moments of Turkish modern popular music, and many, as far as I know, consider Anadolu Pop an inspiration. Contrary to the politically aware Anadolu Pop, there was another tradition called the Türk Hafif Batı Müziği, the light Turkish Western music. And it was also accepted by large crowds, even though the term was somewhat derogatory, light Turkish music. So it was something that supposed to be consumed by the masses. There were songs had very little to do with politics, and there was actually mostly a desire for everyone to love everyone another. There are many examples in the 1950s and the 1960s and 70s of this types of song. But then, one of the most defining moments of Turkish music, arabesque, Now we can discuss hours and hours about arabesque, and we wouldn't be able to complete it. But basically, arabesque is, first of all, it's actually the first cultural product, really popular cultural product of the Republic. It's a Republican phenomena, and it generates from the dynamics. It was generated from the dynamics of the Republic. Mostly, as Meral Özbek demonstrates very vividly, mostly arabesque had to do with the immigration from the countryside to the major cities. Now, trying to find a needle in a haystack, but basically, it is a continuation of the fantasy culture, of the fantasy tradition, and it is a hybrid mixture of Western song writing, folk traditions, and urban Ottoman and urban by the 1960s we're talking about urban fantasy craftsmanship, so to speak. And like urban Ottoman music, arabesque was also banned for a very long time. It was banned, but it was very popular. Orhan Gencebay, the first figure to come out of the arabesque scene, claimed that by initiating the arabesque project, he had in mind the fantasy experience, making local, less accessible traditions more popular. However, arabesque music became much more than just an experiment in music. Arabesque is first and foremost, and that, by the way, I say first and foremost in the popular mind, is a state of mind, that is depression. Okay, that's how it was perceived. Life is not worth living, the world is corrupt, and even love, the only emotion that gives hope in life, is dead. Now, we had this debate with Orhan, with Professor Tekelioğlu, and doesn't agree with me on that too much, and about this, with this perception. But when people talk about arabesque, they talk about kadercilik, fatalism. Okay, that is how it was perceived. Arabesque, because of its fatalistic and overly dramatic style, arabesque was ridiculed and regarded as degenerate. The term arabesque itself is very derogatory. It refers to the artificial origins of this music. Unlike its name implies, arabesque is, as I said, is a mixture of musical traditions, only one of them being Arab songwriting. This was only the one element of this phenomena. Now, as I mentioned, arabesque music was banned, and due to this ban on arabesque on TRT, Turkish radio and television, arabesque singers had only one mean of promoting their music, and that was arabesque film. These were basically teary melodramas that fit beautifully with the sorrowful moods of the songs. For credibility purposes, singers such as Orhan Gencebay, Müslüm Gürses, Ferdi Tayfur had to be actors as well as singers. Their fight for freedom of cultural expression, together with their touching music, made arabesque singers into popular minstrels. Okay? This whole minstrel tradition, we must a little bit discuss about this minstrel tradition. Now, the minstrel is a popular poet whose songs express the emotions of the whole society. Arabesque performers were exactly that. And particularly many of the dwellers of the new shanty towns that were built around the big cities identified with the stories of arabesque songs. the songs were about the degenerate. Some of the songs were about the degeneration of all social structures, the dehumanizing experience of urban life, inequalities in society, and they were very strong and very expressive. As far they were, how to say, they were extreme to the point of the hell with all of it. Like, let's destroy the world. There's a famous piece by Orhan Gencebay by Batsın Bu Dünya, which means let's destroy this whole world if life, men are turning each other into slaves and so on and so forth. In the 1960, in the second republic, between 1960 and 1980, this whole development was also in line with the political polarization that was going on at the time. In the 12th of September 1980, the military decided to intervene for the third time, and the paralyzed political system were brought down by the military. This coup, the third coup, was quite a bloody coup that amounted, for instance, to many of those political passionists, political activists from the left and the right to be imprisoned or to go to exile. Cem Karaca had to leave the country. He had to leave the country, as far as I remember, he was his citizenship was revoked, and only the famous Özal thing that in 1987 the then Prime Minister of Turkey let him get his citizenship back and let him turn come back into Turkey. That was the situation. So this whole tradition of with the exception of Barış Manço, Anadolu Pop and Anadolu Rock received a big blow. Yeah. Now, the 1980s, roughly speaking, are known as the arabesque years. Arabesque became very popular in the 1980s with figures like İbrahim Tatlıses coming into the center of the stage, becoming big, huge stars. İbrahim Tatlıses, today's nickname is İmparator, the emperor. He is probably the biggest figure of popular music today. He sang arabesque along with folk music. His songs were sometimes melodramatic. However, his songs were also about enjoyment, about fun, about social rituals that didn't have to do with suicides or the destruction of the world. And Ibrahim says, and the arabesque of the 80s is less, in a way, subversive. You wouldn't hear too, I think, there are very few statements as such as the hell with it all in the arabesque of the 1980s. This pretty much fit the Özal plan of liberalization. The liberalization was not only the economy; liberalization was also in the cultural field. Arabesque, which was banned for a very long time, began to be accepted by many. Now, moving fast forward. With the 80s being arabesque years, in the late 1980s, something else began to happen. People began to consume more Western culture. The economy was open to imports, and some of these imports were cultural imports, such as TV, the video clip, such as the musical records, music records and cassettes of the time. In the 1980s, with the with the improving standard of living, came also a notion of entertainment, of fun. In the late 1980s, in Turkey, there was a program on TRT, by then the only channel, known as gülelim eğlenelim, which means let's be merry and laugh, basically. And in those programs started to appear the dance groups. Most importantly, Hakan Peker, who became one of the most important, one of the most interesting figures of this fun pop. Pop was about, music was about enjoyment, was about fun, was about living in a way life to the fullest without thinking too much of it. Now the dance groups, in a way, were a prelude to the explosion that was to become pop in the 1990s. In the 1990s, the whole thing changes completely. One, first thing that happens is that the monopoly of TRT is crushed. From 1991, there is a Turkish television is multi-channeled. Moreover, in 1994, Kral, the star group, one of the first actually the first private channel, opens a channel that is solely dedicated to music, to video clips. Out of this channel comes the notion of the modern pop star that has to produce, and Toman maybe will tell us about this, that has to produce also video clips, that has to market himself, market his music not only by selling, but also by producing, but by appearing in the newspapers, by using all the means of marketing that are available at the time. Probably the best example of this phenomena is Tarkan. Tarkan is Turkey's best the biggest musical import, selling millions throughout the 90s and this decade as well. Tarkan managed to bring about a combination of music, Turkish musical sounds and singing styles and beats, and mix them together with a Western orchestration, Western, on the musical side, but also in promoting his music, using video clips, using raunchy photo shoots, and becoming basically a Western pop star. Now, the interesting thing about Tarkan is that Tarkan is by no means a product of state intervention. He's not a project. He's something that came out in a way out of need for a pop star, with the video clips appearing since the early 1990s. Tarkan was basically a result of that development. Now, there is still a lot more to be said, but we won't be able to do that. I just want to finish this with the following statement, this presentation with the following statement. The history of Turkish popular music is the story of democratization. Popular music managed to overcome government restraints and restrictions and became a cultural driving force with its own dynamics. Music turned into a modernizing element in Turkish society by promoting values of openness to new sounds, and most importantly, the value of free choice. Contemporary Turkish music is in effect a synthesis between local traditions and Western elements. In an ironic twist of events, Ziya Gökalp's vision of aesthetic Turkism did actually come true. But it was only with the work of people like Saadet Tinkaynak, the father of fantasy, Erol Büyükburç, the first pop star, Cem Karaca of the Anadolu pop and rock musical style, Sezen Aksu, Tarkan, Mustafa Sandal, all these figures made this process actually happen. And basically, that's it.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Yossi, for that detailed and thorough overview, and very enlightening too, I'm sure, to all of us. So thanks again for that. And now I hand over the floor to Tilman to talk about Turkish pop music. Okay.
Let me first.
Biraz daha çeksene oradan geliyor mu?
Yok o kadar.
Gelmiyor mu tamam.
Sen bu tarafa kay.
Evet, yani, tamam.
Bu tarafa kay.
First I have to correct the professor. I don't have a master's degree. I have done my classes, but my teachers didn't like my thesis. So I went to a military service and never came back. I'm here as a musician. And if you want to have sociological reviews, you should have just turn your faces to another person's life. So I can throw away that because you mentioned everything that I have in my papers. So I'm gonna play songs and I'm gonna give some examples and some detailed musical things in those. Those things he mentioned before. This is the new version of arrangement which appeared in 1960s. This is a new one because I couldn't find it in internet the first time. This is from the 80s, but you know this song. Strangers in the night, sending glances, wandering. In 1960s, the first official song in pop music in Turkey was 1962, I think. And 60s is like the arrangement, writing Turkish lyrics to famous pop songs of the Western music. This is one of the well-known songs of that, İki Yabancı, Strangers in the Night, and Ayşe Pekkan was, and she still is, the superstar of Turkish music. In 1960s, the arrangement was the main force in Turkish pop music. And I'll give it, because he mentioned everything. I have very few things I can mention. And there are two ways of Turkish pop music. 1960s. One is writing Turkish lyrics to foreign songs, Western, most popular songs. And the other thing is like rearranging, reharmonizing the old traditional songs in Western forms. I don't. The second one is not the important thing because 1960s is like an arrangement age. And I'll give you not important but funny thing because in that era I'll find you the only thing I had. Because I tell you, I'm sure music in the understand. The funny thing is, like, in that era, some foreign singers sang in Turkish without knowing the Turkish language, like Adamo, Johnny Holiday, Pepe Alcambri, Juanito, and after that, some Turkish singers sang in fake Turkish, English or French accents their songs. This is one of the most important ones, that one, İki Yabancı. Actually, it's İki Yabancı, but it's like a foreign singer singing Turkish with a fake foreign accent. Second one, this one is Anatolian pop or rock. It's a traditional forms of writing music. And this is Barış Manço, which is known as most important ones. And he is from the golden age of pop music, Dalar Dalar.
Let me say so. We in Israel know this song as Mimata Shikurim from the Taverna. The Taverna TV show. It was adopted in the group and was a very big hit in the mid-90s. No, it doesn't have lyrics. No.
Writers take arrangement style, not original, and even like the idea of that arrangement style as an art form. This was against arrangement, Anatolian program. This is another style that he mentioned. First, you listen out there.
Ya dışındasındır çemberin ya da içinde yer alacaksın kendin içindeyken.
Kapa
dışındaysa çaresi yok kardeşim.
Which means original. Original terminology in Turkish
pop
has lots of arguments.
Meyhane
means original and is not peaceful. But it has some traditional forms of Turkish traditional music, arabesque, with social concern lyrics. After the coup d'etat in 1980s, this was the main force for the left-wingers. They can represent themselves, so they just listen to this song.
Meyhane masalarında kan dolacaksın. Şiirlerle şarkılarla kendini avutacaksın. Yar dışındasındır çemberin ya da
these kind of styles has reached its highest positions. Its highest positions for Turkish society, and because of that coup d'etat or military intervention, they were very restricted, they were very repressed, but they feel better, I think, with this kind of musical style. And in 1980s, again, there were some marginal forms, past marginal forms became popular. I don't know how, but they become very popular. This is Masar Bodeska.
MFM.
It was more urban.
Bu sabah yağmur var İstanbul'da.
More urban style. And they still.
Gözlerim. Dolu dolu oluyor.
Are here.
Bilinmez diye.
Almost for 30 years, maybe 40 years. But
anne sözü dinler gibi masum. Ağladım bu sabah. Günler dayanılmaz oldu. Senden uzak olunca.
The 90s.
Lovely time. Tarka. Tarka is the first and most important star. He's really a bad thing. He is a talented, charming person.
Evin adamını beni orta yerimden çatlatıyor. Ağzım nasıl kızı şişirip şişirip arsız arsız patlatıyor. Belki de bu yüzden vuruldum sahibin olamadım ya. Sağır mı er geç diye seni şımarık değişti mi bu dünya. Çekmiş kaşına gözüne sürme dudaklar kıpkırmızı kırtıyor.
I want to say something about our time, there is something very interesting about the lyrics in the Turkish pop scene of the 1990s. Now, this song is a milestone of Turkish song craftsmanship. Sezen Aksu, the writer of this song, Anatolian idiom, but when they put it together, something very interesting comes up. She uses, for instance, the term senin gibi fındıkıran, yılağın derinden çıkaran. Now, these are two idioms which mean you are a nutcracker, you take the you make the steak leave this skin. Yes. Now, these are two idioms that mean you make me crazy, but when you put them together, nutcracker and taking the snake out of his skin and singing it in a very sexual kind of way, then you basically get the idea. Now that's one of the elements. And that's
right?
Yeah.
And it's the end of the 90s. The end of the 90s. And he but came over to pop music with Atlantic Beach, Ankara, and me. And I'm gonna play my song.
Atlantic Beach, right? Like you said, with Atlantic Beach.
Hani çok sevdiğin o filmi
gördükten sonra
kız
between the pop and rock, mine was. But recently there were some bands who does rock music, and they changed the face of album sales in line, and rock music album sales going strong. This is, I think, one of the most important bands now in Turkey, more represented, and you're talking about.
Just to give you an idea of this type of music, this new generation. Now this was very big, this song is very big. Now, yeah. Rap and metal, that's just basic.
Okay, that's it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well, I want to thank Yossi and Tioman for a very lively and interesting presentation of what has emerged in modern Turkish popular music. I think we learned a lot about the relationship between political change and the relationship between Turkey and the West, and how music has evolved, and how Yossi said this is so closely related to the development of democracy and the freedom of choice, and very enlightening connections made between the music and the political scene, which I found very interesting indeed. So thank you both for your very interesting contributions, and for making this conference, I think, a very special kind of occasion. And I would like to conclude by thanking all those who have collaborated in this effort, and a special word of thanks again to my assistant Ilana Greenberg, who runs everything behind the scenes and makes everything work. We intend to collect the papers presented here This has all been taken by video camera and can be seen on the website, audio video on the website of the Dayan Center. Because I do have a sense that you know, putting in so much effort to organize events like this, we would like something to remain for posterity thereafter. In the old days, we always used to produce something printed. Now we will produce a printed proceedings of this conference, but we will also have it on the website, video and audio, as we try to keep track with time, as these young gentlemen do too. And I think that the conference itself and the publication of the proceedings will also be a fitting tribute to the memory of our dear friend and colleague, Professor Arya Shmulevich, in whose memory this event was held. So again, thank you all for your patience and endurance and being here from beginning to end. And to all the participants, thank you once again. Bye-bye.
Söyle bakalım. Sigara içelim artık.